This lesson is going to look at the differences between non-polar covalent bonds, polar covalent bonds, and ionic bonds. So to start off with, we'll look at non-polar covalent bonds. So we've got two hydrogen atoms represented by these magnets. The larger ring magnet represents the positive nuclei of the hydrogen atoms, and the small ring magnet represents the electrons, or the outer electrons of the hydrogen atoms. Now, as you know from National 5, having one outer electron isn't a stable arrangement for a hydrogen atom, so it is more energetically favourable for the hydrogen atoms to come together and share the electrons. So initially there's a repulsion between the negative charge of the electrons, but as soon as that repulsion is overcome, the electrons pair together and we get the formation of a covalent bond. So what keeps that bond together, really, and the definition of higher, is the shared attraction of the positive nuclei for the electrons in the covalent bond. Now, there are different types of covalent bonds, and to tell which type of bond this is, we need to look in the data book at the electronegativities. In the data book, the electronegativity for hydrogen is 2.2. The definition of electronegativity, remember, is that this is the attraction of an atom for the shared pair of electrons in a bond. This is also going to be 2.2. So because there's a shared pair, shared attraction for the electrons between the two hydrogen atoms, they're bang in the middle. There's an equal attraction. So we don't have a positive or negative pole each side. So we can refer to this as a non-polar covalent bond, also known as a pure covalent bond as well. So that's a non-polar covalent bond, equal attraction or same electronegativities between the two atoms forming the covalent bond. So to summarise, if we look at hydrogen molecule, H2, the electronegativities, the attraction for the electrons in the bond, are both equal from each of the nuclei. So the electrons are bang in the middle, so that's a covalent bond. If we look at fluorine has an electronegativity of 4.0 if you look in the data book. So the attraction for the electrons in this fluorine bond are the same from each nuclei there, bang in the middle there. However, it doesn't have to be atoms are the same. If we look at chlorine forming a covalent bond with nitrogen, chlorine has an electronegativity 3.0, nitrogen has the same electronegativity. So they both have the same attraction for the electrons in the bond. So that's another example of what we call a pure covalent bond, also known as a non-polar bond, a non-polar covalent bond. Okay, because there's no positive or negative pole in this bond. So what happens if you have two non-metal atoms that have different electronegativities? Well, if we look in the data book, we can see that this hydrogen atom has got an electronegativity of 2.2, and this fluorine atom has an electronegativity of 4.0. So fluorine has the greater attraction for the bonded electrons in this covalent bond. And you'll see if I move these along a little bit that there's a stronger attraction for the bonded electrons by the fluorine atom than there is for the hydrogen atom, because of this greater electronegativities. Because there's a greater density of electrons around the fluorine atom, this means there's a negative charge at this end, leaving a positive charge at this end. So we have a positive end, a positive pole if you like, and a negative pole. And we refer to this type of covalent bonding as a polar covalent bond. So to summarise, a polar covalent bond is formed when you have two different elements with different, slightly different electronegativities, resulting in a polar covalent bond, resulting in a negative pole and a positive pole. So to summarise, for a polar covalent bond to occur, you need two non-metal atoms with different electronegativities, slightly different electronegativities. So in this case, hydrogen has got an electronegativity of 2.2 in this hydrogen chloride molecule, and chlorine has got electronegativity of 3.0. Because chlorine has a higher electronegativity, it's going to have a stronger attraction for the electrons in the bond. Therefore, we're going to get a negative charge at the chlorine side and a positive charge at the hydrogen side. If we were to take, say, fluorine joined with nitrogen, fluorine has an electronegativity of 4.0, nitrogen has an electronegativity of 3, fluorine will have a stronger attraction for the electrons, so there's going to be a negative charge at this side and a positive charge at this side. So that's polar covalent bonding. Two different non-metal atoms with different electronegativities, giving positive and negative poles, respectively. So what happens if we have two different elements with large differences in electronegativity? For instance, what if we had lithium, which has an electronegativity of 1.0, and fluorine, which has an electronegativity of 4.0. So fluorine has the larger electronegativity. In fact, the electronegativity difference is so large that fluorine is capable of attracting lithium's outer electron and taking it away and forming a negatively charged fluoride ion. The lithium has lost its outer electron to form a lithium 1 positive ion. So we have attraction between these positive and negative ions, and this strong attraction here is called an ionic bond. So to summarise then, if you have a large difference in electronegativities, typically between a metal and a non-metal, metals will tend to lose their electrons and form positive ions, non-metals will tend to gain electrons and form negative ions, and this attraction is known as an ionic bond. So in ionic bonds, remember, the electrons are given and taken, not shared. This is one note of caution when writing the formula for ionic compounds. So let's take an example, NaCl, okay? Often written as Na plus Cl minus. This does not mean that NaCl can be represented like this, okay? It's not a molecule. When we talk about molecules, we're talking about covalent bonds formed typically between non-metals. So even though we may think of NaCl like this, so this is a sodium and this is a chlorine, you have to remember this positively charged sodium ion could be surrounded by negatively charged chloride ions from different sides. And likewise, the chloride ions could be surrounded by sodium atoms as well. And this could expand outwards into hundreds, thousands of ions into a structure we know called ionic lattice, or a giant ionic lattice, as some textbooks refer to. So this is a giant structure, it's not a molecule. So and when we write the formula NaCl, this doesn't mean that there's one sodium and one chloride ion in a molecule. It means that the simplest ratio of ions in that lattice is one sodium to one chlorine. So if we had MgCl2, this means that in the lattice there's a ratio of one magnesium ion to two chloride ions in its simplest ratio.